So first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for this kind invitation to this nice conference. In my talk, I will like to make an overview of the status of lattice QCD simulations, in particular regarding the properties of strong interactions in extreme conditions. So we know that strong interactions, which are described by QCD, are non-perturbative in the low-energy regime, where the perturbative QCD does not work. So there are various possible analytical approaches which try to attack the problem, and many of these approaches are reviewed and in this conference. One possibility is to compute the theory numerically by lattice QCD simulations. So this is more or less the outline of my talk. I would like to do a couple of things. First, to discuss what is the status of the numerical computations, and I mean what is the computational difficulty to compute the QCD path integral, and what is its feasibility today. And then I would like to discuss a couple of issues where we still have difficulties, or even we fail. And there are two issues, which is the both of them are related to the study of QCD in extreme conditions. So first, the study of the QCD phase diagram at finite temperature and baryon density. And then I would like to discuss the study of topological properties, which I mean theta dependence for QCD at high temperature. And as I will discuss, this is also related to physics, which goes beyond the standard model, in particular to axion phenomenology. So a few words about lattice QCD. As you know, the starting point for computing QCD numerically is the path integral formulation of the theory. So the idea is to rewrite quantum field theory in terms of a path integral, where expectation values are written in terms of an integral of path integral. Then the idea is to discretize this path integral on a lattice, finite space-time lattice in Euclidean space-time, so that we have a finite number of integration variables. And once we have done that, we can think of computing expectation values by means of Monte Carlo algorithms by sampling field configurations proportionally to the Boltzmann factor, and then computing vacuum or thermal averages in terms of sample averages over the finite number of field configurations that we sample. So in the case of QCD and of non-abelian gauge theories in general, there is an elegant way to discretize the theory on the lattice while keeping the theory gauge invariant, which has been proposed by Wilson. So the idea is to rewrite the gauge fields in terms of elementary parallel transporters going from one side of the lattice to the other, while the fermion fields live on the lattice sides. So we have various possible ways to discretize both the pure gauge term containing the gluonic, the purely gluonic contribution, and this is done usually in terms of plaquette variables, so in terms of traces of the product of parallel transports along closed transports. Instead, the fermionic action is written in terms of a bilinear form of the fermion fields. And this form, which is called the fermion matrix, is a matrix which is built in terms of the link variables of the elementary parallel transports. So, as usual, fermion fields can be integrated out, and finally, the partition function of the theory is written as a functional integral over the gauge fields only, which are weighted by two factors, one coming from the purely gluonic term, and the other coming from the fermion determinant, which contains information about dynamical fermions. So as long as this term is real and positive, we can interpret the partition function in terms of we can give a probabilistic interpretation. So we can think of sampling the gauge configurations according to this weight by a Monte Carlo algorithm. And in doing this, the most challenging part from a numerical point of view is to take into account the fermion determinant. Okay? In particular, this part was numerically inconceivable in 1974 when Wilson proposed it, but it has been feasible today, as I will discuss in the following. So, what is the sampling strategy? I would like to discuss briefly the typical Monte Carlo algorithm when we include also dynamical fermions. So, for instance, this is the path integral that we would like to sample in presence of two degenerate flavors, which is a typical situation for QCD with two light flavors. So the stochastic variables that one would like to sample are these link variables, so the parallel transports from one side of the lattice to the other. This is the weight. So the standard, one of the mostly used algorithms is the Ibri-Monte Carlo algorithm, in which one introduces a set of auxiliary fields. The first fields are the so-called pseudo-fermion fields, which are used to bosonize the determinant so that we can trace it numerically. And the second auxiliary fields are the conjugate, so-called conjugate momenta, which live in the algebra of the gauge group. And after writing this in this way, the typical algorithm samples the conjugate momenta to the gauge fields and the pseudo-fermion fields like Gaussian variables. They are simply Gaussian variables. And then the gauge fields are evoluted with an algorithm which resembles the usual molecular dynamics algorithm, which are used also in condensed matter physics. So we have a molecular dynamics evolution along this trajectory. And at the end of the trajectory, one performs a metropolis step to ensure that the algorithm is exact. Now, the most expensive part in this algorithm comes during the molecular dynamics evolution, because the part of the force which is used in this dynamical evolution, which is used to compute the derivative of momenta, involves the computation of the inverse of the fermion matrix, actually of the fermion matrix times MM Dagger. So this inversion is the most expensive part, and we'll discuss, this is strongly related to the physical properties of QCD, okay? So let me go to the computational complexity. So let me take for granted that the most expensive task is to invert this matrix M. What are the characteristics of this matrix? Well, this is a sparse matrix because it usually connects only nearest neighbors on the lattice. But it is a huge matrix, which is L over A to the 4 times L over A to the 4. It connects every side of the lattice to the other side. So here L is the spatial size of the lattice and A is the lattice spacing. So L over A is the number of lattice spacing in one direction, and we live in four dimensions. So we have this kind of dimension plus color and flavor indexes. So what are the typical values of L and A that we would like to use in a realistic simulation of QCD? Well, the spatial size must be largest, large enough, in particular, largest than the largest physical length that we have on our lattice. In our case, it is the inverse of the pion mass, which is a lighted state in strong interactions, which means much larger than one fermi in size. The lattice spacing, in order to have control over the lattice artifacts, must be small enough, and in particular smaller than the shortest length. So it must be much smaller than the inverse of lambda QCD, at least, which is around 200 MeV. But depending on the physics that we would like to study, it must be even shorter. For instance, if we want to study heavy quark physics, we need lattice spacing at that scale. So given these two constraints, we end up with a number of lattice sites in each direction, which should be at least of order 100, which means a matrix which is of this size, 10 to the 8 times 10 to the 8. Now, during the inversion of this matrix, the most important characteristic of this matrix is its condition number, I mean the ratio between the smallest and the highest eigenvalue. So the highest eigenvalue of the matrix, so this matrix is basically the discretization of the Dirac operator plus the mass term in the fermion action, okay? So the highest eigenvalue is of order 10, say that the parallel transports are SU3 matrices connecting the different sides of the lattice, and there are order 10 different nearest neighbors sides on the lattice. What about the smallest eigenvalue? Well, there is one property of QCD which is essential. Now it is chiral symmetry breaking, which means that the Dirac operator has a number of eigenvalues which is are very close to zero. So that means that the smallest eigenvalue is basically dictated by the quark mass, okay? Because we can have zero eigenvalue for this term. And this is related to chiral symmetry breaking. So that the smallest eigenvalue is of order A times MF squared. And another property of QCD is that it is almost chiral, meaning that the mass of the two lightest fermions, lattice quarks, is much less than the typical scale of the theory, which is lambda QCD. It is of the order 10 to the minus 2. So that means that if we want a lattice spacing which is much smaller than the inverse of lambda QCD, we need A times MF, which is at least of the order of 10 to the minus 3. Okay, so we end up with a condition number which is huge for this matrix. And this is the origin of the computational difficulty. So what can we do to fight against this? We can proceed in two ways, by either devising new algorithms which permit to approach this inversion and all the molecular dynamics better. And so I report here an estimate which was done in 2001 of the effort, numerical effort, which is needed to produce a certain number of the correlated gauge field configurations which are used to sample the path integral. So the estimate is the following. Here, the various parameters are the lattice size, both spatial and temporal, the quark masses, and the lattice spacing. And this is given in terms of teraflops per year, means a machine of one teraflop used for 1 year. And if you use this number, you end up that to produce 100 well-correlated configurations with the physical quark masses, in 2001, one will need of the order of 10 to the 26 floating point operations. Okay. Now, there are a number of improvements on the algorithmic side in the years. Here there is a short list. So the molecular dynamics is based on symplectic integrators. So one can use higher order symplectic integrators, multiple step integrators. One can use preconditioning for the matrix, and one can do what is called deflation, I mean computing exactly the lowest eigenvectors and factorize them out. So after these improvements, the situation 10 years later, so I report an estimate which is at the lattice conference, which is 11 years later, was for the same number of the correlated configurations went down to 10 to the 22 floating point operations. So that means a gain of the order of four order of magnitudes. Okay. Now the other possibility is to fight by building new machines. Lattice QCD has been right from the beginning a laboratory for the construction of high-performance architectures. So after the Wilson proposed this way to discretize QCD on a lattice, the first numerical simulations were done by Mike Kreutz, and he started the lattice QCD simulations without dynamical fermions, which is easier, on a machine which had a power of 10 megaflops. in around 1979. Now, Lapis QCD has been a laboratory for the construction of new machines. Here, I just remember the series of APE machines which have been built by INFN. This project was pushed by Nicola Cabibbo. And there was, I mean, at that time, it was a beautiful era for the construction of new high-performance architectures because, I mean, there was a time where physicists were sitting down and thinking of what was the best architecture to do what they wanted. I mean, one of the powers of the APE processor, one of the features was to be able to do complex algebra directly, something which was unthinkable for the industrial processor at the time. So this was one example, and then also the series of BlueJean machines which have been developed by IBM basically follow this proportion coming from lattice QCD simulations for the construction of new machines. An interesting question is who wins? I mean, it is better to think of better machines or of better algorithms. So I focus here over this period, going from 2001 to 2012. Of course, if you do the same exercise for different periods, it can be different. But in this period, there has been a factor 10 to the 4 improvement in algorithms, which is what I discussed. And what about machines? Well, if you compare the most powered machines on Earth, which is given in this top 500 machines that you find online, in this year, you see that there is a factor 10 to the 3 improvement. So basically, in one decade, we had an improvement of 7 order of magnitudes, which is most essentially coming from both sides. So slightly more from algorithmic improvement, but for that can depend on the exact period that you choose. So both things are essential for the progress of the field. So nowadays, we can say that we have reached the possibility of performing realistic simulations for several aspects of strong interactions. And here I show, for instance, one picture showing the determination of hadron masses. And nowadays, we can reach a precision on the determination of hadron masses, at least for the lowest lying hadrons, which is at the level of 1%. Okay, in the following year, I will focus on some particular aspects of lattice QCD simulations which regard QCD under extreme conditions, meaning high temperature, finite baryon density, which are aspects which are fundamental for various fields, going from astrophysics, cosmology, and the physics of heavy ion experiments. So when we want to compute QCD at finite temperature, what we do is just to compute the functional integral in Euclidean formulation with a compactified time. And of course, the compactified time gives the inverse of the temperature. So sample averages give us access to equilibrium properties, so we can compute the properties, the equilibrium properties of different phases of the theory and study the nature of the phase transitions. Of course, what we cannot do, at least we cannot do trivially, is the computation of out-of-equilibrium properties and of transport properties. So when we go to finite temperature, of course, one of the most important questions that we would like to answer is whether QCD deconfines, so whether the Kodor degrees of freedom liberate at some stage. And whether other essential properties of QCD at zero temperature change, like chiral symmetry breaking. So there are clear evidences that indeed the confinement takes place. So this is a nice picture taken from a study of some years ago, which was done by in the theory without dynamical fermions, but similar results are obtained with dynamical fermions. And this is a study of the static potential between two static, between a static quark and a static antiquark. And you see that in the low temperature regime, you have clearly a linearly rising potential, meaning that there is confinement, while in the high temperature regime, the potential flattens and we have the confining properties of the theory are lost. There are also other ways to see that indeed there is this transition by looking at the thermodynamical properties of the theory. So this is the behavior of the energy density of strongly interacting matter as a function of temperature, and you see that there is a sharp jump at a temperature which is of the order of 200 MeV, and the energy density goes rapidly to a value which is close to the Stefan-Boltzmann limit for an ensemble of free quarks and gluons. The same jump is seen also in the quark number fluctuations. So these are the susceptibilities of the numbers of U up and down quarks. And you see that there is also here a sharp jump, which means that these degrees of freedom are getting liberated. And at the same time, we have more or less at the same temperature, we have that the chiral condensate, which is another parameter for chiral symmetry breaking in the vacuum, goes down. So more or less at the same temperature, we have both the restoration of chiral symmetry and the confinement. Now, what is the temperature of the transition? Now, there is agreement between different lattice groups. And if we take the temperature from the chiral condensate, so from the point where the chiral condensate drops, we get a temperature which is of the order of 150 MeV. Now, what about the nature of the transition? So in QCD, we don't have, when we have finite quark masses, we don't have exact symmetries. So we have exact symmetries of the theory for in absence of dynamical quarks, in absence of dynamical fermions. And we have also exact symmetries when we have exactly massless fermions. In this case, we have chiral symmetry. But for physical quark masses, there is no exact symmetry, so there is no reason to expect a true transition. And indeed, this is the case. We have that at the physical point, simulations with quarks with the physical masses show that there is no discontinuity or no divergence appearing in the thermodynamical quantities, so that we have simply what you usually name as a crossover, so an analytic jump between two different regimes. Well, of course, we can also study, we can change the quark, the masses of the quarks as we want in the numerical simulations. We can change the number of flavors. So we can study how the transition changes as a function of the quark masses and the number of flavors. And this information is summarized in this plot, which is known as the Columbia plot. So in this plot, along this axis, you have the up and down quark masses going from zero to infinity, and here you have the strange quark mass going from zero to infinity. So basically, this is the two-flavor theory with just two flavors of quarks. And you see that there are first-order transitions appearing just in the limit of very high quark masses, which are quenched to the, which are close to the pure gauge theory, and for light quark masses. So for instance, in the NF equal 3 theory, going to the chiral limit, one expects also from universality arguments that there is a first order transition. And this is indeed the case in lattice simulations, even if there are issues concerning the continuum limit of this prediction. Now, the QCD phase diagram is not just temperature, so we would like to explore the theory also introducing new parameters like a baryon chemical potential, which is a relevant parameter to describe heavy-ion collisions, or astrophysical objects like neutron stars. We can also introduce other parameters like external background fields, magnetic background fields, and so on. So up to now, I discussed the finite temperature behavior of the theory, where we have a phase transition which is not a true phase transition with a critical, pseudo-critical temperature of the order of 150 MeV. There are various questions that we'd like to answer. For instance, how the location of the critical temperature changes as a function of these parameters, as a function of the baryon chemical potential, for instance, and what are the properties of the different phases. And in particular, there is the one possibility that is predicted by effective models of QCD, that in this region, the low temperature and high baryon chemical potential region, the transition becomes first order. So in this case, one would expect a critical endpoint of this first order line if the transition at zero chemical potential is a simple crossover. So in this case, we want to introduce a baryon chemical potential. We face one of the problems that are currently unsolved in QCD. And the reason is that when we try to compute the grand canonical partition function with a non-zero baryon chemical potential, the Fermion matrix, so the Dirac operator, gets modified because you have to introduce a chemical potential in the action. The Dirac operator changes so that the determinant of the Fermion matrix becomes complex. Okay. So the Dirac operator is anti-Hermitian at zero chemical potential, it is no more anti-Hermitian when you introduce a non-zero baryon chemical potential. So that means that we cannot apply standard Monte Carlo simulations, which are not feasible. And there are a number of ways to deal with this problem approximately. And approximately, I mean that these methods are effective and viable only for small values of the chemical potential. And they are listed here. I mean, the first is Taylor expansion. So essentially, one can try to reconstruct the properties of the theory for small values of mu of the chemical potential by computing expectation values at mu equals zero, by computing the Taylor expansion of the partition function as a function of mu. Another possibility is to use what is called reweighting. I mean, one can sample the partition function with a weight which is given by taking the modulus of the determinant and then take the phrase in the physical observables. And then another possibility is to make simulations at imaginary values of the chemical potential. So if you take here mu b as a purely imaginary quantity, then the determinant is positive again. And you can think of making analytic continuation of your results from imaginary to real chemical potential. Well, all these methods work well only in a limited range of mu over t and do not solve the problem completely. Up to now, we are still missing a way to solve the problem completely. There are several approaches which are being tried, like performing Langevin simulations or adopting the density of the states method or performing simulations on the Lefschetz symbol, or trying to rewrite the wall partition function in terms of new variables so that in terms of these new variables, the weight is positive again. But none of these methods are still fully operative for lattice QCD. They work in some simplified models, but still we don't have results for full theory. So what I can show you as a reliable results for the phase diagram are just results which regards the physics at zero, at a small baryon chemical potential. And one of the questions that can be answered today is, what is the behavior of the pseudocritical temperature as a function of the baryon chemical potential for small values of the chemical potential? So in this case, you can perform a Taylor expansion of this quantity and take into account just the first term of the expansion, which is quadratic in mu because the theory at zero chemical potential is invariant under charge conjugation, so the partition function is an even function of the chemical potential. And this coefficient here is the what is called the curvature of the pseudocritical line. So it gives information about, let me go back a couple of slides, the curvature of this line at mu equals zero. So how this line starts to bend down as you increase the chemical potential. So for instance, I will show you some results obtained by the method of imaginary chemical potential. You can think of rotating the chemical potential to the imaginary side. So if here mu is the core chemical potential, you take an imaginary mu, and the expectation, if the theory is analytic at around zero chemical potential, the expectation is that the critical temperature will move in this way with just a change of sign from here to here, so that you can obtain the value of this parameter, kappa, by simulations at imaginary values. So in practice, what you do is to repeat your simulations at non-zero values of the imaginary chemical potential. So for instance, this is the value of the chiral condensate at zero chemical potential at non-zero chemical potential. So you see that the transition moves to higher temperatures. Here we have the temperature axis. And this is the susceptibility of the chiral condensate. So you can determine the transition either from the flex point of this of the chiral condensate or from the peak of the susceptibility of the chiral condensate. In both cases, you see that the critical temperature goes up. And so if you take the so the critical temperature obtained from the different quantities as a function of the chemical potential squared, you can fit the behavior for small values of the chemical potential and extract a value of the curvature, I mean, of the linear dependence in mu squared. And so this is the results that we obtain. Here the band is the one standard, two standard, three standard deviations which obtain from our computation. And these are compared with the determinations of the what is called the freeze-out points in the phase diagram. I mean, the freeze-out temperature, which is the last point of equilibration for hadronic matter coming out of the fireball, which is produced in AIM collisions. So this is obtained from numerical data obtained from our paper. In this case, instead, I report different values of the curvature from different lattice collaborations. You can see that apart from some results which are from a few years ago where maybe systematic effects were not well under control, now there is a good agreement between the different lattice determinations for this curvature, which is here compared also to the determinations of the curvature from the freeze-out curve, so from experiments. Now, unfortunately, this good control over systematic effects that we have today for the physics at small baryon chemical potential is not attainable at the moment for the determination of the critical endpoint. So there are different determinations of the critical endpoint, but from different collaborations, but no clear convergence of results and no control over the systematic effects. So let me switch to the last subject of how much time we have, Steve? So one last issue is theta dependence in QCD. So we know that gauge field configurations which are relevant to the path integral are divided in homotopy classes, which are characterized by a winding number, which is the topological charge. So the QCD partition function can be, the QCD action can be modified by introducing a parameter which is coupled to the topological charge, the so-called theta parameter, which gives us a new version of QCD which is still normalizable and presents an explicit breaking of CP symmetry. So in this case, the Euclidean path integral is also, the measure is also complex, so direct simulations at non-zero theta are not possible. But as for the case of the finite chemical potential, we can think of making an expansion of the free energy of the theory in terms of this theta parameter, and the coefficients can be computed by simulations at theta equals zero, so by standard simulations of QCD. And for instance, the first term in expansion is the so-called topological susceptibility. The probability distribution at theta equals zero, which determines the coefficient of this expansion, is a fully non-perturbative property of QCD. So numerical simulations are the best way to compute it. So what are predictions about theta dependence? We can make analytic predictions in some regimes. For instance, we know that there are classical solutions having a non-zero winding number, which are the instantons. One can perform a perturbative expansion around these solutions and obtain an effective weight for instanton solutions, which is the following, but is based on a one-loop expansion. And here, G is the coupling at the radius of the instanton, at the scale of the radius of the instanton. So this expansion is expected to break down for large instantons, and indeed it does so in the QCD vacuum. But when we are at high temperature, instantons of large size are suppressed by thermal fluctuations, so that the perturbative expansion is expected to work well. And so we expect to have instantons with an effective action, which is the following. That means that instantons are strongly suppressed at high temperature as the temperature increases, and we can treat the theta dependence in terms of an ensemble of instanton anti-instantons which are non-interacting among themselves because they are very dilute. So this is the so-called dilute instanton gas approximation, which gives us a very well definite prediction for the behavior of the topological susceptibility as a function of temperature, which is suppressed as a power of the temperature, which with a power low, which is with an exponent which is close to -8. Instead, when we are at zero temperature, reliable estimates comes from chiral perturbation theory, which gives us an expectation which is for a susceptibility around 80 MeV to the fourth. Now, what is the interest in QCD at non-zero theta? If we look at experiment, non-zero theta breaks CP symmetry explicitly, but we know from experiments, in particular from experiments regarding the electric dipole moment of the neutron, that there are very stringent limits on this amount of CP violation, which sets a limit around theta, which must be less than 10 to the minus 10. So the question is, why do we bother about theta dependence? Well, there are several reasons. First, theta dependence enters phenomenology anyway because there are, for instance, in the Witten-Veneziano mechanism, the topological susceptibility in the quantum limit is related to the eta prime Meson mass. But also the question is why theta is equal to zero. And this is one of the open questions in the standard model which points maybe to physics beyond the standard model. So one possibility would be to have a zero quark mass, which is a possibility which is ruled out. There is another mechanism, which is the Peccei-Quinn mechanism, which invokes the existence of a new scalar field, which is the axion, whose properties are largely fixed by theta dependence. And by the way, axions are also a popular dark matter candidate. So their phenomenology is particularly important. So what is the idea of the QCD action? Very shortly, There are several high energy models which predict QCD actions or extension of the standard model, which basically end up with the same effective low energy effective Lagrangian, in which we have this scalar field, which is the Goldstone boson of some U1 symmetry, which is spontaneously broken. This is the Peche-Quinn symmetry. And the axion field is the boson Goldstone of this spontaneously broken symmetry. It is a pseudo-Goldstone boson because there is also an explicit breaking because the axion couples also to GG dual, to the topological charge susceptibility. So it's like having a Mexican hat potential which with a tilt, which is due to the coupling of the axion field to the topological charge density. So what happens is that the axion, the potential takes a minimum, and this minimum corresponds to a zero effective theta. So it explains why zero is theta is zero in QCD. And it also gives to the axion a mass. And a mass, the mass of the axion is related to the curvature of the potential around the minimum. And this curvature is related to theta dependence from QCD. Okay, so it is related to theta dependence from QCD. So in particular, we can write a relation between the axion mass and the topological susceptibility divided by this coupling constant FA, which appears in this low energy Lagrangian. So basically, one can fix the axion parameter during the universe evolution by knowing what is the evolution of the topological susceptibility, so of the axion mass as a function of temperature. The main source of axions that we can think to have today, the main mechanism is known as misalignment. So the time where we have the spontaneous breaking of the Peche-Quinn symmetry, the axion field is not aligned around the minimum, and this that gives you some energy which is spent in the production of axions. So one can write an evolution, assuming a zero-mode approximation for the axion field, which is like a damped harmonic oscillator, where the damping term comes from the universe expansion, so it is related to double constant, and the harmonic force potential is given by the mass of the axion. So depending on the values of the two quantities, the harmonic oscillator can be damped or can oscillate. And since the Hubble constant goes down with the universe evolution and the mass of the axion is expected to go up because it is related to the topological susceptibility, and the topological susceptibility is suppressed at very high temperatures. So it goes up as you decrease the temperature. There is a point where the two quantities cross and this oscillator starts to have oscillating solutions. From that time on, you can write an adiabatic invariant which fixes the number of axions today. So essentially, the amount of axions which is due to this mechanism is fixed by this crossing point, which is fixed by the behavior of the topological susceptibility in QCD, essentially. Okay? So if you want to set a bound on the amount of axions, which is fixed by the amount of dark matter that we see today, we can set a bound on this coupling constant, FA, which is an unknown constant in the model. And on the other hand, that fixes a value for the mass of the axion today, okay? Which is important for the experiments which try to compute the axion, to detect axions today. So, just my last few slides. We can study QCD topological properties by lattice simulations. There are a number of issues. Let me go to the most important issue that is why I'm discussing it here. One problem which is met by standard algorithms which try to sample the functional integral is that the topology is a continuum property of gauge fields. So as you go towards the continuum, standard algorithms start to have difficulties in changing the topological sector. So they should change the winding number of gauge fields, and this becomes more and more difficult as you approach the continuum because you should go through gauge configurations which are discontinuous, and this is suppressed by the functional integral measure. So we skip this slide. So what happens is the following. This is the topological charge evolution during three different Monte Carlo simulations for three different decreasing values of the lattice spacing. And so you see that this is as a function of the Monte Carlo time. You see that for lattice spacing, which are around 0.1 Fermi, you have a good evolution. And as you go below 0.05 Fermi, the algorithm gets stuck. I mean, it's not ergodic anymore. It's not able to explore the different topological sectors. So you cannot sample what is the value of the topological charge distribution, P of Q, which is needed. Now, small lattice spacing, when you go to finite temperature, means high temperature. So basically, we have a difficulty of computing the topological susceptibility at high values of the temperature. Okay, which is what we would like to do to have relevant information for axion cosmology. So this is the result that we have obtained in our study, which is surprising because we obtain an exponent for the decrease of the topological susceptibility, which is half the prediction of the Dirichlet instanton gas approximation. But we are able to go up to, 600 MeV. We will need to go to a few GeV to say something really relevant to axion cosmology. If we believe that this exponent for the decrease of the topological susceptibility is true, we get a value of the axion mass today, which is around 10 microelectron volt. The Dirichlet instanton gas approximation will predict a value which is around 100 microelectron volt. This difference is fundamental for experiments because it means detectable or not detectable, okay, by experiments which are available today. And in this case, we need new algorithms to go to higher temperature, and there are several possibilities which are being explored. So I go to my conclusions. So I've shown you that numerical simulations of QCD on a lattice represent a numerical challenge which is has been approached successfully for several aspects. I mean, we had progress both on the development of algorithms and of new machines, so that we have now reached a mature time where we can make precise QCD predictions about several aspects, like hadron masses and flavor physics. But there are still some hot issues which need progress. And in this case, progress does not mean just improvement in the algorithms, but it means breakthrough. I mean, we need some really new algorithm to deal with the freezing of topological modes in the continuum limit, or to be able to compute QCD at finite baryon chemical potential. So we need a breakthrough in new algorithm or in the computational approach. And of course, one possibility for the future is also quantum computing, and we will have a few talks in this conference. So that's all. Thank you.